My name is Seth Berge. I'm from Lansdale, Pennsylvania, the southeastern corner of PA. I've lived there my entire life, and I do many things while I'm there, mostly music, though. Cantate is singing two pieces this year that both use the text, the Lord's Prayer, and I wrote one of those settings. So it's, as you can imagine, the Lord's Prayer, it's a prayer setting, and I envisioned that the music was kind of a solitary, intimate prayer, and you'll notice a bit of wandering in terms of the tonal center. There's a lot of different tonalities that it kind of ventures through. But I was trying to get with the way that I said it, to portray that kind of way it is sometimes in prayer, where we have this idea and then we have that idea. So there's a lot of different ideas, but yet they also all come into this one vein of prayer and that prayer being before God. So I chose this text. I'm not sure if it was a wise idea, but there are bountiful settings of the Lord's Prayer, that text. Many, many, and many great ones. I simply wanted to try my hand at it. And I'm definitely not going to say that mine is among the greats, but it was a really enjoyable time to set it and to think about the text a little bit more. And also, not only to think about what the text is saying, but how I could maybe, through the setting that I chose, help that text to connect to the people, to people who hear it. When I set the text to the music, I try to always be conscious of having musical choices that will reflect the text, so that they aren't just two separate things, a nice text that you have and music that you like and you just smash them together, but rather that the music would amplify the text, and also that the text would then wed into the music and that they could be one unit. You'll notice at the end, you see this a bit more starkly, and lead us not into temptation. It becomes this fairly aggravated and a bit of an angry, perhaps, musical choices, rhythms, tonalities that I chose. While the prayer is to lead us not into temptation, the idea is that these temptations are coming at us, and so it's trying to encapsulate that struggle. And this all builds up, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the power and the glory. And so at for thine, we finally have that resolution, for thine is the kingdom and the power. And then right after we sing power at a very powerful forte, we have silence, and we come back in at the same chord, the exact same pitches, but down an octave. And the glory forever, amen. So that was an attempt to have that kind of breadth of the kingdom and the power, and then the glory be this shimmering and thing that we're just stand in awe of. With this piece specifically, I set about to do a couple things. One was to keep it to just four voices, so the voices never split out like they sometimes do. It's completely four voices. And the piece could be sung by four people, as long as you have a soprano, tenor, alto, bass. The phrase lengths work with that as well. Sometimes phrases go for very long, but in this piece I tried to keep them so that one person could sing one phrase, and then there's a natural place for breath. I was trying to be as simple as I could without hindering the expression and what I wanted to do with it. My hope is that when people listen to this, they would be reminded of what Jesus said right before this prayer, actually. And the disciples asked him, how should we pray? And he said, after this manner, pray. Within the prayer, Jesus touches on a lot of very profound things: the power and majesty of God, the reality of sin in our lives, and the way that we can be, you know, forgive us as we forgive our debtors, the way that we can be reconciled to that majesty, the kingdom, and the power and the glory, what Jesus was kind of all about.